What is up, my dashing dudes and darling dames? I am the Hans TV, and welcome back to the subreddit that is all about getting even with those who have wronged you. It's r/pro-revenge. Our first post for the day actually comes from my subreddit, the Hans TV YT, and it's from Seraphine1. School bus driver gets revenge. This was years ago, but I was a school bus driver with a really rowdy group of middle and high school children. Every day, these kids would pull the emergency exit handles, which would cause the alarms to go off and force me to pull over. Then, I have to get up and check every single alarm handle until the alarm shut off. Problem was, I couldn't catch who was doing it. Even finding kids at the seat with the alarm, I wouldn't know which one it was, and none of them would confess or rat their friends out. This went on for a while, where I would make kids in the seats with the alarm going off all sit up front for a week as a punishment, but the alarms kept going off. Then one day, I had an idea. Before my route, I took Vaseline and I wiped huge globs under the handle, just out of eyesight, under each and every alarm handle. So you couldn't see the massive amount of mucus-like substance, but if you touched it, like when you tried pulling it, you would feel it. The trap was set, but it was hot that day, so the viscosity of the Vaseline was much more mucus-like than I could have hoped for. The kids all piled onto the bus. Down the road we went, when all of a sudden I hear a girl scream as the alarm goes off. Oh my god, what is this? Ew! I smiled and pulled the bus over, got up from my seat and walked up to her and said, "Gotcha!" She kept screaming, wanting to know what that snot-like substance was. I had her suspended from the bus for 2 weeks, and then the rest of the year she had to sit up front. For the rest of the year, not once was the emergency alarm ever pulled again. I guess they were afraid of xenomorph mucus, lol. Hey OP, thank you for posting this in the subreddit, I really enjoyed that story. Our next post comes from ArsonBiblo12. Several years of harassment caused her to lose a job and her kids. This is my first post ever, so apologies if it's not up to standards. Longtime lurker on this site, so I figured I might as well tell my story. Here is some backstory for ya. Several years ago, my mom was dating this nice man with two kids. My younger brother and I liked the boyfriend himself, but his kids were another story. His kids were entitled jerks that always got what they wanted, constantly stole our toys, and were genuinely a nuisance to be around. I always tried to be a better person, but my brother and I were constantly getting into arguments with them due to their pettiness. They, however, weren't even the worst part of the relationship. The boyfriend's ex-wife was. From my perspective, I felt that she was the type of person that if she couldn't have him, nobody could. She made our lives hell, constantly filing false complaints about our side of the family, generally pointed at my brother and I. From harassment to claiming I had stolen the son's toys, which was the other way around, and going after the boyfriend, claiming he was an unfit parent. Several times she'd try and ruin any plans he had come up with. For example, after spending months planning a trip to New York, last minute she blew a fuse and demanded we cancel the trip so that she could take her own trip with them. We had already gotten written agreement from her. One time she even demanded the older son and I visit a family therapist. After pointing all the blame on me, I told my side of the story. It resulted, without the therapist fully implying, that they agreed I was in the right and then storming out of the room. Among many other reasons, even after my mom and her boyfriend had gotten engaged, the ex-wife was one of the biggest reasons my mom had decided to call off the engagement. The harassment and drama were just too much for us. It broke her heart to do so, but she made us the priority and got us out of the situation. A few years after the breakup, my small family and I were living happily. I never saw the kids or the dude again. My mom had still kept in touch with the former boyfriend, but after some time apart, she's seen the faults in him too. I was in the 8th grade and living life happily. That was until the ex-wife stepped into gym class one day. Apparently since the breakup, she had gotten her teaching degree and became a substitute teacher. She was now replacing our normal gym teacher who was on maternity leave, as well as acting as the assistant teacher for our health/sex ed class. Basically, I now had to see her pretty much every other day for the rest of the school year. At first, she didn't recognize me. Puberty had hit me hard, changing my appearance drastically, especially for someone who hadn't seen me in like 5 years. Eventually, she recognized my name, and that's when the harassment began anew. All of it was snide remarks about my appearance, constantly pointing me out as an example as to what puberty can negatively do to you, pimples, facial hair, voice cracking, that sort of stuff, to the class, as if I was the only one dealing with it. The main health teacher didn't know about it either. Basically, everyone in 8th grade was taking sex ed at the same time. It was technically one extremely large class, but split up into male and female groups. And wasn't I lucky that the ex-wife got the male half? Mine. I told my mom about it immediately, and she was livid. She sent multiple emails to the school requesting that they switch teachers or at least let me take the class online. It all fell on deaf ears until, with the help of the ex-boyfriend, we showed them dozens of emails, phone calls, and messages, all spouting harassment at my family and I. This resulted in her being fired from the school and basically being blacklisted from our school district and the surrounding area. If she wanted another teaching job, she would have to find it elsewhere. This also resulted in a major legal battle between her and the ex-boyfriend because she had tried to move out of state with the kids without his nor the court's permission. Apparently, she lost custody of the kids and had to go back to her old job. I don't know what it was. All in all, it was an interesting experience. We cut all ties with that entire family after the whole ordeal and went on with our lives. I'm now a sophomore in college, waiting out the lockdown in my state, while my mom still hasn't had a long-term relationship since then, mostly sticking to online dating. One of them turned out to be a pedo, but that's a story for another day. But she's happier than she's been in a long time. Thank you for reading, and as stated before, I've never done something like this, so I apologize for any issues. I thought you all might enjoy a new story during these trying times. First off, OP, this formatting is absolutely fantastic. There's nothing wrong with this story, and it really was pro-revenge. You got that lady fired and pretty much exiled. Also, as the son of a teacher, who was also my teacher, the way that she was presenting herself to these kids and making fun of them, that just makes me angry, because I know that my father would be, like, up her butt about that. Our next post for the day comes from Alex, followed by a lot of numbers. Woman damages my mom's car and blames my mother. Her corrupt cop boyfriend covers it up and ruins both of their reputations. For some background, I live in a predominantly white, suburban town in New Jersey, and my family is Asian. Although the town is alright for the most part, it is not really a secret that some of the townspeople are pretty racist. One of our neighbors, let's call him Anthony, is a retired police captain from another town, but he is friends with my town's police chief. My mother is a first-generation immigrant, and although she's fluent in English, she still has a pretty thick Asian accent. A couple of years ago, my mom went to visit one of her friends on the other side of town. My mom had parallel parked directly in front of her friend's house, which is at the bottom of a small hill. As she was leaving, a woman driving a Jeep Wrangler with her children was driving down the small hill, but she was a decent distance back, so my mom pulled out of her spot. The road they were on was really wide, wide enough space to fit 5 cars next to one another, and about 40 feet ahead was a stop sign. My mom at this point was already in the middle of the road, fully out of the parking spot, and had gotten about 10 feet when the woman driving the Jeep suddenly came up from behind my mom's car and cut directly in front of her, crossing a double yellow line to do so. Because of the angle she cut off my mom at, the Jeep's rear wheel ended up ripping off my mom's front bumper. My mom naturally immediately stopped, and the woman got out of her car after straightening it out on the road. As soon as she stepped out of her car, this woman, we'll call her Karen, immediately starts cursing my mom out at the top of her lungs. Karen told my mom to call the police, but my mom told her that her phone had died. My mom's friend and her son, as well as the neighbor, came out of the house after hearing the commotion to see what happened. The neighbor, an elderly man, asked what had happened and Karen yelled, "Are you effing blind? A effing accident happened. Go call the police, I need to call my boyfriend." The son had taken a law class in college, so he offered to take a bunch of pictures of the scene of the accident and send them to my mom later. This becomes super important later. The neighbor calls the police, but Karen's boyfriend arrives at the scene first. When the cop, let's call him Kenny, finally arrives, he asks my mom what happened. Just as my mom had started saying her side of the story, the cop says, "Wait just a minute," and walks over to the boyfriend. As it turns out, the boyfriend, we'll call him Sam, was a cop in the town who was pretty popular with the kids in the middle schools since he would occasionally visit to talk about the things like DARE and other things in assemblies. Sam was off duty at the time, so he was able to come over when Karen called him in. As soon as Kenny saw his buddy Sam, he immediately went to go talk with him, rather than with my mom or with Karen. They discussed for a little while, and afterwards sent everyone on their way. My mom tried to talk to Kenny before he left, but Kenny just brushed it off and said he got the details he needed, and that my mom would be able to get the police report in about a week or two. When my mom received the police report, she saw that it said that she pulled out without using her blinkers suddenly and hit Karen's car. On top of that, Karen was expecting from my mom's insurance to pay for the damage done to her rear wheel. My mom went to my neighbor Anthony to ask what she should do about the report, since it was clearly wrong. Anthony was furious and told her that she should go to the police station and ask to see the chief, and if they ask why she needs to see him, she could tell them it's because she wants to file an internal complaint. That day, my mom takes the photographs sent to her by the son and goes to the police station and asks the person working the front desk to see the chief. The cop says that she could not just walk in and ask for the chief, so my mom responds, "Okay, so where should I go to file an internal complaint?" And the cop immediately straightens up and says, "Oh, right here, come with me." He leads her into the back. The deputy chief steps into the room and started recording the conversation. Since the chief was out, my mom presented all of the evidence to him instead. After presenting the evidence to show that it was in fact Karen that hit her instead of the other way around, my mom also says that she would like to file a corruption complaint against both Kenny and Sam. Kenny clearly did not do his job properly, since he did not properly ask the actual people involved in the accident and did not even note the fact that there were two passengers in Karen's car in the report. Even Karen later admitted to an investigator that Kenny never once spoke to her. My mom even threw in the racist card for good measure, saying that maybe Kenny wouldn't listen to her and brushed her off because of her thick Asian accent. Sam, meanwhile, had interfered with the investigation despite not being at the scene of the crime during the time of the accident. The deputy chief says he will start an internal investigation and will see if anything needs to be done. Meanwhile, my mom also filed a claim to her insurance and presenting the evidence to them too. And her insurance decides since the accident, in their eyes, was clearly not her fault, they weren't going to pay Karen a penny, and that they would contact Karen's insurance to pay my mom instead. A lot of internal bureaucratic investigational BS happens, including interviews with Karen, my mom's friend and the friend's neighbor. About a month passed, and an officer comes to our house to tell my mom that Kenny had been punished, but there was not enough evidence to punish Sam, and he just wanted to know if there was any other concerns she had. Since Karen seemingly had not done anything to further warrant any action, and the damage to the car was paid for, my mom said that there was nothing else. Now, this is the fun part. 3 days after the officer came to our door, a letter came in the mail for a court hearing. As it turns out, Karen decided to file 3 tickets about my mom, just 1 day before the statute of limitations. Apparently, in New Jersey, citizens are allowed to file complaints about other citizens breaking the law, a thing that our family had never heard of before until this happened. And because of how late she filed these complaints, by the time we received them in the mail, we could not even counter-complain, and the only options were to pay the fine or go to court. We assumed that Karen learned about being able to file the complaint from Sam, because, duh. And that the only reason she was willing to go this far is because she heard my mom had a super thick Asian accent, and assumed that my mom wouldn't know what to do about the tickets and would just pay up. What she didn't count on was the fact that my mom is actually really aggressive with an absolutely massive network of people that she knows. Within a day, my mom hired a lawyer to fight the case, and they immediately asked to change the court from the small court in our town to one of the large courts a couple of towns away. The logic was that if she fought the case in our town, my mom would be at a disadvantage since her case was essentially going against our town's beloved police force. But by putting it in a different town, the playing field would be even. Additionally, while my mom worked from home in her own business, Karen had a full-time job in town, so going to court in a different town would be a huge pain in the butt for her. The lawyer had prepared a huge amount of evidence against Karen, so there was no way she was actually going to win the case, no matter what. Comes the court date. Karen never showed up, so the case was thrown out. Now that was a pretty nice win, but what came after was even better. Since my mother and sister have a lot of friends in town, the story of Karen and Sam doing this shady bullcrap got out really fast. Soon, half the town had heard about it, and suddenly Karen and Sam went from 2 favorites in the town, because of Sam's reputation, to 2 of the most underhanded and nasty people. Sam stopped getting invited to school assemblies, and Karen was ostracized in her kids' school PTA. Anthony also ended up talking to the police chief in private, and we found out that although Sam was not officially punished, he was severely reprimanded by the chief. Now, my question is, why wasn't Karen and Sam arrested? I mean, falsifying a police report is a felony, so they should have been arrested for that. Our final post for the day comes from Jeremy R. Cook. EK chops down my tree, and it costs her £500,000, $700,000. It's been 2 years, and I can finally post about this. This is juicy, so get ready. background information. We live in an old and big manor that has been split into three attached houses. The houses are about 150 years old and were built around five huge giant sequoias, which were about 200 years old. In the UK, giant sequoias are very rare, and the two in our garden upped the house price by about £60,000. We live next to two really nice neighbors, one young couple and one old couple. The story. Unfortunately, our old neighbors passed away, so their child and her family moved in. Let's call her Jo. Jo was instantly a pain in the butt. We had been sharing chickens with the previous neighbors, and Jo agreed to keep sharing them. However, on her nights, she would constantly forget to put them away, so we'd have to check them every night anyway. One night, her little brats thought it'd be funny to open our personal duck pen in the night, which led to a mass slaughter. Later, the chickens went the same way. About 2 years ago, there was a storm, and one of her sequoias somehow fell over and died. They were distraught, understandably, but from then on, the jealousy started. She would constantly complain about how lucky we were to have our two sequoias in our garden, and how our sequoia was making too much shade in their garden. It wasn't. Anyway, we just thought it was Jo being a pain. There were a few dry threats like, they will chop it down, or maybe the next storm will blow it down. Until we came back from a holiday to France to find a huge 6-meter stump and nothing else. I mean, how the heck do you get rid of a 100-foot tree in like 2 weeks? Two of our old British oak trees had been crushed as well. My mom and sisters were crying, and my dad was red in the face, and we had no evidence that Jo had done it. She claimed that there had been a storm, and she had to get rid of it. We had a security camera at the front of the house, but you can get in the back if you go through a few fields. We were given an £8,000 bill for damages to her property, and to have the tree chopped up and removed, the wood alone would have been worth a small fortune. We had lost all hope, and 2 weeks had passed when my dad came running in from the garden. We had put up a wildlife camera a few months ago, and it had caught everything. We got a lawyer on the phone and started our revenge. We got a tree surgeon out who said it was an original specimen brought into the UK in 1860. Along with two that were in Elveston Castle Country Park, there were 218 around the UK, but only 60 now. He also told us to call an engineer because the roots might be in the foundation, so when they rot, it could damage the house. Turns out, we would need to redo the foundations. Then we took Jo to court and sued them for damage to property, trespassing, and lots of other small claims. The tree alone would cost $250,000 to have another sequoia that was 200 years put in and looked after. It's basically impossible. Plus the damage to the foundation, which was $200,000, and the two oaks, which were another $25,000. So with the smaller claims, it went on to be about £500,000, $700,000. They had to move out. And we have now paid off the mortgage, done a lovely loft and kitchen conversion, and have basically done up the house and garden, as well as plant a 60-year-old sequoia tree in the back garden. We also had our kitchen counter and table made from the old sequoia. We now have a lovely family living next to us who we share chickens, ducks, and pygmy goats with. They're very nice, and I make a fortune babysitting their kids. Sorry for the essay. Imagine being so vindictive that you cut down an ultra-rare tree and have to sell your house to pay it off. Anyway, that's gonna do it for today's episode of r/ProRevenge. I hope you liked the stories, and if you did, I'm gonna link them down in the description as always. And if you liked the video, subscribe, share, drop a like, and a comment down below which you'd like to see me read next. A humongous thank you to everyone who is subscribing. I cannot thank y'all for how y'all are helping the channel grow, and I can't wait to see who we outreach and how we grow in this next year. Thank y'all so much from the bottom of my heart. But with that being said, I will see you in the next video.